Hello, everyone, and welcome to Harv's World for another episode of Pirate's Bay Farm. Yes, we are back in the Caribbean, and before we get started, I would like to say welcome to Stitchikins, Juelsey, Mortifer Stein, Nicholas Blom, Evan Olson, Hindrance, Judd Erickson, George Nunez, Enrique Escamilla, and Sawyer Wells. Welcome to Harv's World, everyone. Welcome. I hope you're enjoying what you're seeing here. Thank you very much for being a part of it. So, as you can tell, it's about 1:15 in the morning, and I am headed down to that southwest dock again. I guess what we should just really refer to as Smuggler's Cove at this point. Much easier to say, and a much better name. I really do kind of think there is a band of smuggler pirates on the island, or smuggler farmers on the island, or what I like to think of as farmer pirates or pirate farmers, whatever you want to call them. But there's definitely a black market working here. And luckily, Lisbeth has managed to help me out through that channel, so no complaints about that. Now, once again, I did talk to her about the fact that I'm looking for a slurry tank. Explained to her how I was going to manage a little extra fertilizer on the farm, and asked if she couldn't hook me up, as it were. And same situation. I fronted her some money, and she told me to be down at this dock, this Smuggler's Cove, at between 1 and 1:30 in the morning. So that's where I'm headed now. There goes that helicopter. Interesting. Anyway, speaking of smugglers and pirates and all of that, today we are going to be talking about Henry Avery, the most famous pirate you've probably never heard of. Very famous in his time. In fact, he was known as the King of All Pirates, not because he was a leader of all pirates, but because his exploits during the day were so well known that he was sort of branded King of All Pirates for what he was able to accomplish in a very short amount of time. He pulled off, as I mentioned last time, one of the biggest pirate heists in recorded history, at over $200 million in today's dollars. Absolutely amazing. In fact, when Henry Avery, it's either Avery or Avery, some pronounce it Avery, E-V-E-R-Y, some Avery, A-V-E-R-Y, when he was pirating, guys like Calico Jack, Rackham, and Blackbeard, and the pirates that we know and have immortalized, these guys were still kids. And it's suspected that Henry Avery is responsible for the tales that led many people into piracy because of his famous exploits. What's this crap? What the heck's going on? All right, this is creeping me out. Okay, I don't know what all that was about. And yeah, my tank is about, well, not quite the same place, but it's right where I expected it to be. And I'm grabbing this thing and getting the heck out of here because I don't know what those fools were doing. But whatever it was, it's not cool. No point in keeping the lights off now. These guys are It's shining like a bunch of fireflies. What the heck, people? Ugh. Time to go. Oh, good. And they pulled up behind me. Great. I'm not stopping. If I get ticketed for missing a stop sign, it's just too bad. I'm moving out of here because this is uncool, to say the least. Very uncool. And this hill is so steep, I can't really pick up any good speed. And they're all following me. Good God. Come on, tractor, pull. Pull like the wind. And of course, what does it do? It slows down. Come on. We have got to get out of here. All of a sudden, I feel like I've done something very, very wrong. Very wrong. I can tell you one thing, though. A certain lady friend of mine has some serious explaining to do in the morning. Serious explaining to do. And oh yeah, of course. Here they come. I mean, I guess it's not like they have a different road they can take out of here, but still. I don't like them following me like this. It makes me very, very nervous. I guess I better focus on driving instead of watching them. I told you there were farmer pirates around here. Regardless, I am getting the heck out of Dodge. Trying to, anyway. This hill is not making my life any easier at the moment. Come on, go tractor, go. I'm not too far from home now, and I'm not stopping. Not stopping for any stop signs. Just gonna keep this thing rolling. I'll get a little bit of a run up the hill at least. And of course they all came this way too. What is it? What is the deal? Slowly but surely getting closer to the farm. Come on, tractor. There we go. I can finally get on a little bit of a flat space and really get running here. Just get me back to my farmyard. And these fools can go do whatever it is that they're gonna do. Oh yeah, Lisbeth, you and I are going to have a serious talk in the morning, let me tell you. That's right. That's right. You all just keep on going. Move along. Nothing to see here. Go on. Get. Uh-huh. Ugh. Yep. Yep. We're going to have a serious talk in the morning. That's all I've got to say. A very serious talk. Unsettling, to say the least. I can tell you, I'm probably not going to get much sleep tonight. Well, as promised, I did not sleep much last night. Didn't sleep much last night at all. I actually came out here about 5:30 in the morning and decided to roll my new grass field and finish off the fertilizer, which I'm pretty much done with at this point. And you can see I picked up a couple additional rollers because this is a good sized grass field now, and it's going to take some extra big fertilizing to or rolling, I should say. I'm not technically fertilizing anything, but the rolling, compacting the soil, does help keep things growing quite nicely. And I am not going to disassemble this rig at this point. It's too much trouble. I could make it bigger if I wanted to, but right now I don't want to. I'm just going to drop it right here. Head back to the farm and give that new slurry tank a try and see if I can't get a hold of Lisbeth. This is a very good looking slurry tank, let me tell you. It should hold a decent amount. It's a good size. What I'm really concerned about is how much digestate do I have accessible. That's what I want to know at this point. And we are just about to find out as soon as I get over to the biogas plant. So I should be able to fill up just right about here. Yep, that works, that works. Oh, we've got 190,000 liters of digestate built up, so it's not one-to-one, you know. It's not not one-to-one silage to digestate, but it's doing pretty good, because I've put in probably a good 300,000 liters at this point. And this thing should have a pretty decent spread width on it. I'm just wondering how far. So we've got 18,500 in the tank at this point. I'm wondering how far that will go before it runs out. But we're going to test it right now and see. I'm going to hope against hope that I'm lined up about right here. Let's see what we got here. Well, it's a spreading. And it looks like I'm real close to the field edge. Boy, it's dumping quick though, isn't it? Get back on my line. Just make sure that I'm right on the edge. And stay there. Not doing too bad. Yeah, we could get a few passes in here maybe with one tank. Very nice. I mean, it's not exactly a huge spread that we're getting out of that, but it's working. I'm trying to see if we can see exactly. Yeah, oh yeah, you can definitely see the moisture being left behind there. Outstanding. This is what we needed badly, very badly. Some real fertilizer, not any weird rollers or whatever you want to call it. Genuine real life spreading. That's doing pretty well. I'm liking it. I like it a lot. We might get two or three passes per tank load here. Keep your fingers crossed. I know mine are. Because I'm tired of jumping through all the hoops to get this done. So grass is Grass makes the crops grow, let's put it that way. I definitely wouldn't want to be back there when this thing is squirting its juices out, though. It does not exactly smell good. But hey, as long as the job is getting taken care of, that's what really matters. And you know, that reminds me, I think it's time to make a phone call. Hang on just a second. Hello, Elizabeth. How are you this morning? Well, I'll be fine as soon as you can explain to me what the heck was going on last night. Yeah, I'm upset about it. No warning. So, what was that? What was that all about? You tell me right now. So, I don't want any beating around the bush. I don't want any lame excuses. Tell me what was going on. Okay. Okay. So, what you're telling me is that these people that you have your connections through, whatever, decided that if this was going to continue to take place, if this was going to happen, if they were going to do business with me, as it were, they needed to know who they were dealing with. All they had to do was ask. They didn't have to come down to the dock like the frickin' farmer mafia. Well, you tell me why I shouldn't be upset. Seriously. Because frankly, I feel like I have good reason to be upset. Well, frankly, I was pretty unnerved by the whole situation. I mean, I come down there in the middle of the night and all of a sudden, I've got a bunch of guys circling me in tractors. Well, I understand that what they're doing isn't exactly within the limits of the laws on this island and that it needs to be protected. Do you not think my interests are involved here too? Why would I jeopardize it? It's only going to get me in trouble. Yeah, because I have stuff on, you know, I have stuff that I'm not supposed to have now also. And if they ever come snooping around, I mean, I can't hide this stuff because I need to use it in my fields, but that would put me in just as much jeopardy as them at this point, so I really don't understand. Okay, well, I hope this doesn't happen again because I know I'm going to need more stuff and yeah. And I know that getting it on this place can be challenging sometimes, and this is a good way to do it, and I appreciate it. So I'm certainly not going to go ratting or whatever they want to call it, but I hope this is an isolated incident and they're satisfied with whatever they need to be satisfied with, so I don't have to sit there wondering if I'm going to make it home that night. Okay, you get back to work. I'm going to get back to work. And we'll discuss it over dinner. Okay. Talk to you later. Bye. So I'm sure you pretty well picked up on what that was all about. But I'm still not terribly happy about it. I mean, the logical part of me says, yes, I understand they need to protect themselves and make sure of who they're dealing with. At the same time, you know, I don't appreciate being frightened. You know, that kind of surprise is not a good surprise. And I like a good surprise as much as the next guy, but that wasn't it. That's not a good surprise. So, anyhow, this job is getting done. The equipment is working as well as can be expected. Exactly what I was hoping for. Genuinely able to spray off this field. Thank goodness for small favors. And I'm going to keep spreading digestate. So we'll catch back up again, talk some more about Henry Avery in just a little bit. Digestate down. Well, the rain has really decided to come in. See, now you'll get a taste. Now you'll get a taste of what I'm talking about. When the rains come here, the rains really come. But field 44 is fertilized. No rollers. I guess I did put oilseed radish on that for the first go around, but still. No rollers this time around. Take forever, although spreading digestate actually it wouldn't be bad if let's just say it wouldn't be bad if I didn't have to fill up every three passes. But hey, I don't care. It's genuine actual fertilizer that I can make myself. I don't have to worry about illegally purchasing anything. And now I need to get down to the old cotton field and get it prepped up. Luckily, today is not a harvest day. If it was, we would just be shutting down for the day because I'm telling you, this rain is going to go on and on and on. But that gives me a chance to get back to Captain Henry Avery, pirate extraordinaire. And as I was saying earlier, Captain Avery started his career with the Royal Navy. Did quite well there. They say he was born around Portsmouth, England. in a place called, or maybe it was, I don't know, I can't keep my England straight. Newton Ferrers in Devon. I'm probably all over the place, so I apologize to those of you out there who live in the United Kingdom and have to listen to me butcher all of these places and names. But anyway, that's where he was born, somewhere around 1659. Oh yeah, he's been around for a good long while. And yes, the cotton field does need lime. Luckily, that's something that is not in short supply on the island. We can get all we want because there is a lime mine here. I guess they consider it a cement factory, but it looks more like a mine to me anyway. After leaving the Navy, Captain Avery, well, soon to become Captain Avery, joined a private vessel known as the Charles II. And this vessel was, it was just a full-blown warship. And this ship, well, they were looking for letters of marque from Spain to go out and fight the enemies of Spain. Well, lo and behold, the owners of said ship, when they hired the crew, promised them wages paid every 6 months, no matter what, and they had to sail to Spain to pick up these letters of marque. Well, they got to Spain, and it turns out that for whatever reason, Spain was withholding the letters of marque. They didn't come, and they sat in port for months and months and months. And the next payday came around, and guess what? Surprise, surprise, as we've talked about before, these merchants, these whatever you want to call them, held out and didn't pay the crew. Needless to say, the crew became more and more disgruntled, as did our future Captain Avery. And ultimately, what did Captain Avery do? Well, he organized a mutiny. These guys, peacefully actually, no blood was shed, took over the Charles II, sailed out of port under the cover of darkness, and Henry Avery, now being elected captain by the new crew, the old crew that's now the new pirate crew, renamed the ship the Fancy. So Henry Avery and Fancy went about doing their piratey duties and captured 11 ships over the course of the next several months. Now keep in mind, Henry Avery was only a pirate for about 2 years. He had a very short but incredibly lucrative career in the pirate business anyway. But they were sailing around Africa. You know, they were not in the Caribbean. And one of the things that Avery liked to do, or seemed to like to do anyway, was he would raid English merchant vessels. And as we've said before, a lot of pirate booty wasn't in the form of gold and gems. It was in the form of trade. It was in trade goods. Anyhow, one of those trade goods, believe it or not, were captured slaves out of Africa. Yes, England was very much involved in the slave trade in Africa, so much so that you had to be licensed to be a slave trader, ship captain, or ship owner. If you weren't licensed, you were essentially a slave bootlegger. Which Avery actually did for a time before he joined up with the crew of the Charles II. So he would go and illegally capture slaves and put them on the market in Africa. but now he's on the Charles II, renamed the Fancy. He's down in Africa. He sails around the Cape of Good Hope. He's still plying his trade, taking slaves. Now he's capturing ships, but he used to like to, he would capture British ships and then write letters to the British saying, you know, this ship has never touched a British vessel, so there's no need for the British Navy to come after us. Maybe to some degree he was a little bit afraid of the British Navy. I think they were pretty much the world power at the time anyway. You know, between them, Spain and France. He knew better than to mess with the big boys. So, after a good stint capturing ships, like I said, 11 of them, Avery caught wind of a 25-ship convoy heading out. I want to say it was from India. And two of these ships actually were heavily laden with gold, jewels, that kind of thing, and very important people to the hierarchy in India. The Grand Mughal, if you will, not to be confused with Harry Potter. I believe it's Mughal, or maybe it's Mughal, but it's M-U-H-G-U-L. So, Avery knows that in his one ship, and now he had gone from about 80 pirates on his ship to up to 150. So he had really started to gain quite the crew. And everybody were volunteers, except for one person. When they took over the Charles II, Avery let any man go that didn't want to be part of the mutiny, except for the ship surgeon. And you remember me telling you how important a doctor could be on board? Yeah, they forced the doctor of the Charles II, the surgeon, to remain on board to take care of the pirate crew. Anyway, Avery catches wind of this convoy heading out. It's the Grand Mughal's convoy. Two ships in particular he had his eye on. And what does he do? Instead of trying to do this himself, he recruits five other pirate captains to join him. Five other pirate ships. Because he knew that he was going to be terribly outgunned. Even just the one main ship, the one big treasure ship, was going to kick his butt. And he knew it. So he was going to need help. So with a fleet of six ships, and now he's not just Captain Avery, he is Admiral Avery of a full-blown pirate fleet. They go and track down this convoy. Well, of course, the treasure ships, being the most heavily laden and the largest, were the slowest. They were lagging behind. And the pirate crews, attempting to catch up with them, actually ended up abandoning two of the six ships that they had, and the crews merged with Avery's aboard his ship. And they didn't just abandon the ships, they physically burned them so no one else could use them against them. So they catch up with the first ship, and it was called the Fatah Muhammad, I believe. Yes, that seems about right. And, you know, four ships against the one. They take it down pretty much no trouble whatsoever. And this ship alone had between 60 and 70,000 English pounds worth of treasure on board. And, of course, these guys are pretty ecstatic at this point. But they also know that there's another big ship out there with their name on it. And they keep going. And lo and behold, they catch up with another ship named the Ganya Dao Ganjisawa. Don't make me repeat that. But this is a huge ship. It's a massive ship. It's got 80 cannons on it. and the pirates were really very much outgunned, even 4-1 ship-wise. But Avery got off a lucky volley on his first cannon shot and took out the main mast of this ship, which reduced its mobility and allowed the pirates to board the ship. Also, during the battle that took out the main mast, one of the guns aboard the Indian ship exploded and caused a great deal of catastrophe on board and disorganization, as you can imagine. Now, keep in mind that Avery and the pirates maybe had 200 to 300 fighters between them. This Indian ship, and I think most people have just reduced the name of it to Gunsway. I think they call it the Gunsway. Anyway, this Indian ship had 400 musketeers. 400 guys who were ready, willing, and able to fight to protect the ship. Well, the cannon explodes on board the ship, kills a bunch of people, causes a lot of disorganization. The main mast is down, so the ship is immobile. The pirates pull up alongside and start climbing aboard. Well, there was a brutal and bloody battle, as you can imagine, with swords and muzzle-loading rifles and pistols. And it lasted for 3 hours. Can you imagine in close quarters like that, a battle that was raging for 3 hours? People fighting, slashing at each other, black gunpowder smoke hanging in the air, acrid, the smell of smoke and blood all over the place. And apparently, the captain aboard the Gunsway panicked. And there's one rumor that says he actually sent like 20 slave girls to fight in his stead. Now, there's been some dispute as to whether any of that's true or not, whether the captain actually ignored his duty and gave up. But it's definitely possible. Definitely possible. Although how a captain would have been put in charge of the responsibility of a ship like that and not had a fighting spirit is kind of beyond me. It doesn't seem terribly reasonable, does it, when you think about it? Anyway, the battle raged for 3 hours. And ultimately, the pirates won. But the depredations that they put upon the people that were left on that ship were absolutely horrid. They were aboard that ship searching for treasure for a week. They knew that a lot of it had been hidden away, and they pretty much tortured and raped everybody aboard the ship. In fact, some of the women got knives and killed themselves because they didn't want to be dishonored by the pirates. And they couldn't go back and face their husbands or their fathers or anything once their fathers knew that that's what they had been through. So life was incredibly unpleasant for a great many people for about a week aboard that ship. And in fact, you know, some of these people were direct relatives of the Grand Mogul of India. One was an elderly lady, and you know, they didn't pick or choose. They're like, okay, you're aboard, you're a target. But they tortured, raped, and forced people to tell them where the treasures were hidden. Ultimately, they got away with between 400 and 600,000 British pounds worth of treasure in Indian gold. And my understanding is that that is worth somewhere around $200,000 in today's dollars. And that one haul made Henry Avery incredibly famous throughout Europe. And in fact, now at this point, we have all seen the documentaries, the you know, America's Most Wanted, or the FBI's top 10 list, or you know, whatever you can think of. Well, Henry Avery is credited, another credit to the man's name, as creating the first ever worldwide manhunt. Because not only did he steal treasure, he did almost irreparable damage to the trading companies that relied on trade between England and India. And not only that, they had to pay back India for all of the treasure that Avery stole. It was insured. So, needless to say, they were quite unhappy with Mr. Avery, and the first worldwide manhunt ever began. At one point, one of the companies, I think it was the East India Trading Company, or the East India Company, put a bounty of 500 pounds on his head, and then somebody doubled that to 1,000 pounds, which in today's dollars would be about $90,000. So they weren't mucking about. They wanted him, and they wanted him bad, and they were not going to settle for anything less. And we're going to learn about the fate of Captain Avery here in just a little bit. Well, I got the field cultivated. The rain keeps on coming. Look at that. No sign of it stopping anytime soon. But I brought the seeding rig down because I forgot for a second I needed to get oilseed radish in here for some fertilizer action before I could put my sunflowers in. On the plus side, the planter that I have, even though it is a little bit small, not bad really, but a little bit small, will plant right over the oilseed radish when it's ready. So it's a direct drill. It will drop those sunflower seeds right in and cultivate in that oilseed radish all at the same time. So that's pretty freaking handy, let me tell you. And with this big rig and this smaller field, well, I can tell you it won't take long to finish up. Now, I did do the headland passes before we got back together here just to get things a little bit squared away. And where would I be without glorious GPS? Although it does take some time for these the heads on these cedars to drop back into place properly. You know, it's not... well, I'm not going to complain. I'm happy to have it. So, Henry Avery captured the Grand Mogul ship and took off with a whole bunch of treasure. Now, of course, that treasure was split amongst the four crews that were part of the battle. But Henry Avery said, I think it's time to get out of Dodge. He knew the heat was going to be on after taking a prize like that. And this is where he becomes synonymous with the golden age of piracy, especially in the Caribbean. Because where did he go? Well, he set sail for New Providence. New Providence is the island in the West Indies, also known for its capital city of Nassau in the Bahamas. And that's exactly where he went. And he changed his name, which of course he had to do because everybody knew who Henry Avery was at this point. He became Benjamin Bridgman. At least that's what he told the folks in Nassau. Now, the governor of Nassau was not inclined to let this ship dock or let its inhabitants come to the island. For one reason or another, he said, you don't look like the kind of people we want on our island. Well, Captain Avery, alias Benjamin Bridgman, also known as Long Ben, to his crew. He said, well, Mr. Governor, I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse. And he bribed the governor with outrageous sums of money. Obviously, he had it to spare. Not only did he offer the governor money, however, he turned over his ship, the Fancy, to the governor. And not only that, in the hold of that ship was 50 tons of ivory. Now, Henry Avery was responsible for the first worldwide manhunt ever. And of course, the authorities said, be on the lookout for coins minted in India. Because that was going to be a dead giveaway, obviously. Anybody carrying a large bunch of coins from India were going to be suspected to be part of Avery's crew or any other crew that participated in the taking of that prize. Well, NASA in the Bahamas, at this time, the mid-1690s, was kind of a boring place. The pirates didn't have a lot to do. There weren't many people there. And they soon got bored and decided to go their separate ways. Now, they're all rich men at this point. Every member of Avery's crew that participated in taking that ship were very wealthy men. And, of course, Avery knew that he could not continue a life of piracy. And he, of course, gave up his ship already to the governor, but he also disbanded the crew. Everybody went their separate ways. Blah, blah, blah. And at this point, the trail goes completely cold. Nobody genuinely knows what happened to Henry Avery after he reached Nassau in the Bahamas, other than the fact that he bribed the governor with large sums of money, with a ship, and with 50 tons of ivory. Now, many of Avery's crew did end up becoming captured because, you know, as you probably can guess, these are not the sharpest tools in the shed sometimes. Some of these seamen, and that's not to say the seamen aren't bright, it's just these guys turning to a life of crime weren't exactly smart about it. So many of them were captured, many of them were hanged or otherwise for the crimes that they had committed. And there is actual testimony from them about the depredations that went on aboard the ship, the Gangway or whatever you want to call it, when they took that prize and the week they spent aboard searching for treasure and the atrocities they committed to the people there, especially the women. That is on record. So historians, of course, have brought all of that together to let us know about what Henry Avery and his crew managed to accomplish or were notoriously dastardly for. And that does give you some perspective into the life of pirates. We romanticize pirates, but they were truly bad men. You know, we enjoy watching guys like Captain Jack Sparrow and, you know, name your favorite on-screen pirate. It's always thrilling. It's always exciting to watch that type of thing. But this was common. The types of things that Henry Avery's crew did were pretty much what pirates did. These were not pleasant people. They were angry at the world. They wanted to turn the world upside down. If you've ever heard somebody make a comment like, I want to watch the world burn. Well, that's what these guys were all about. They wanted to completely disrupt society. It wasn't just about stealing. It was about changing the world view, about limiting people's ability to discount the little guys. So Henry Avery got away. Now it's suspected that, of course, he took his treasure and either fled back to England under an alias, or he possibly came to the Americas, came to the United States or Canada or somewhere along the eastern seaboard, the Atlantic seaboard of North America. It's very possible. There was a lot going on the eastern seaboard of the Americas at that time. One of the rumors about what happened to him exactly is that he pretty much died completely impoverished. That he had been swindled out of the money that he had as part of the loot that he took. Now, frankly, I find it hard to believe that a guy who was smart enough to command a ship, and after only 2 years basically becoming an admiral of a pirate fleet, could get swindled out of all of his money and end up destitute begging on the street for coin. I mean, nothing is impossible, of course. I mean, who's easier to swindle than a thief? Because if you know he's a thief, who's he going to tell? Is he going to go to the authorities? Is he going to go crying to the Privy Council and say, "Oh, these guys cheated me out of my ill-gotten booty"? No, of course not. But still, I think Henry Avery was smart enough to avoid being cheated in that fashion. That's my own personal opinion. But regardless of what happened to Henry Avery, how his life ended up, he did become a hero among the pirate community. I mean, literally, he is known as the king of all pirates. And you can just imagine, on pirate ships, people would say, you know, if I'm a captain on a pirate ship and I'm trying to inspire my crew, you know, it's going to be, remember Henry Avery, remember what he was able to accomplish. We could do the same thing. Let's go out there and let's go get them, boys. You know what I'm saying? Let's get out there. Let's grab some ships. Let's grab their loot. We could stumble across a fortune just like Avery did. And that did happen from time to time. Avery was not the only one. He was not the only one to capture treasure ships. Because frankly, you know, at that time, you've got countries like Spain, who are ransacking South America, taking all the gold from the Incas, the tribes in South America. And they had to have some way to get it back to Spain, and well, they put it on board ships. And plenty of those ships have gone down. I mean, one, you know, a big occupation throughout the world for people is treasure hunters for ships. They still go out searching for sunken treasure, and there's plenty of it on the bottom of the ocean that still hasn't been found. So, Digestate, Field 44 completely done. Field 49 here has been completely prepped and ready to go. Get some oilseed radish in there and it'll be time to plant some sunflowers. No problem. The grass field is plowed and fully fertilized at this point. So it's just a matter of grassing up. And I've got silage cooking. So it's been a busy couple of days, but this day especially busy. I'm going to go have a chat with Lisbeth and see if we can't get some things straightened out. I'm sure we will. It shouldn't be that big of a deal, but I'm still a little bit tweaked about it, if you know what I'm saying. But I think that's going to do it for our time here on Pirate's Bay Farm. I hope you enjoyed the episode. If you did, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button down below. It really, really does help. I appreciate you coming along for the ride. And until next time, take care.